But man, we kicked off this series about Thrive, called Thrive. You are designed to thrive. I truly believe that every single person in this room was made by God for a purpose, on purpose, to thrive. You are not just to survive, but to thrive. And so we started this series, and I got kind of this idea from a study that was done. And it looked at all these different churches, and the ones that were healthy, that were flourishing, that were growing, that were advancing the kingdom of God, they came up with 8 different ingredients or things that were happening around this church or in this church. And when all 8 were present, that church was healthy and growing. And as I was going through it, I thought, man, that's what we need to be teaching our people. This is the ingredients that you need to thrive. And as I was going through, I was thinking, man, let's make a series out of this. So last week, we talked about the soil of your soul. You are only as healthy as the soil contents. And so last week, I forgot an illustration of bringing up dirt. So this week, we've got dirt. So I hope you can see it okay. And really what we talked about was that the gospel, the good news, the word of God is being thrown out like seed. And you and I have the gospel deposited in, or maybe not if you're not a believer, that's okay, you could be here. But the gospel is being preached, and the Bible says that in a story where the farmer went out to sow, that some seed fell on good soil, some hard soil, some fell on rocks, some fell on a path, some fell on the thorns. And depending on where the seed landed, that will then determine how the grass will grow or how the plant will grow or how we'll flourish. And the same thing is true for you and for me. You can have the best seed in the world. In fact, I brought some seed with me, and you can't really tell, but this is grass seed. I'll bring the little bag out just so you can see it. But this seed has fertilizer wrapped around it. It's got blue fertilizer. It's also got some other ingredients. This is like super seed, like ultra powerful. It should grow, but here's what's interesting. I can take this super seed, throw it on the gym floor, and what's going to happen? It's going to die. If anybody's confused, it will die. But take the same seed with all the superpowers and put it in the right soil, put it in, and guess what happens? It will grow. Same is true for you. Some of us here, you're going through life and you're surviving, and you need to reevaluate the soil contents of your life. Last week, number one, we said that the first ingredient the soil of your life needs to have is passionate love for God. Passionate love for God. And we looked at a church in Ephesus in the book of Revelation, where Paul says that you've lost your first love. And so what was the prescription? Repent. So change the way you're thinking. And then do the things you did at first. Same advice a lot of counselors give to married couples that have fallen out of love. What was the things you did when you first fell in love? You talked on the phone till 4 in the morning. So maybe if you're struggling, just wake up at 4 in the morning and call your wife. Call your husband. He's right next to you. Hey, we're going to do the things we did at first. And what ends up happening is that we think, our culture says, your emotions drive your actions, but actually, right decisions drive your actions, that and your feelings will follow. Your emotions will follow. Your passion will come back. My prayer for you is that you would have passionate love for God above all else. So how do we do that? We worship the Lord like we just did. We also talk about Scripture, the power of God's Word. If you have your Bibles, we're going to be in Ephesians 4 in just a moment, and I would encourage you to grab that. But also, maybe you're like a lot of people, and you read your Bible on your cell phones. I would encourage you to grab it out, because today we start something brand new. If you have the YouVersion Bible app, our church is now on the YouVersion Bible app. All of our notes are on there. Now, I'm going to warn you, for those of you that really this bothers you, okay? You should have been got handouts on the way in. The answers to the handouts are on the Bible app already. So just a fair warning, I've given you permission. It's not cheating. There is no test, but it's right there on the YouVersion apps. All you have to do is hit search churches, and then when you go on there, you'll see Portland Christian Center. Just type it in there, and there we are, and all of our notes are right there for you to have. And we have, the reason I'm doing this is because I want to take away every single barrier I can possibly have for you to fall in love with Jesus. We have technology. Let's leverage it for the glory of God. Amen? So you can do that. Also, we have scripture memorization. So every week, you're memorizing scripture. Wasn't that cool to see Titus recite a verse last week? Wasn't that good? Yes. Good job, Titus. This week, we have another memory verse that's on your notes. You can fill it in, and it's on your YouVersion app. We want you memorizing the Word of God. Why? Because nothing will change your life faster than getting yourself saturated in the Word of God. Why? Because that's one of the best ways to reveal Jesus to you, to reveal the Holy Spirit to you. And when you start encountering the love of God through the Word of God, you will be transformed and you will begin to thrive like never before. My prayer is that you will passionately fall in love with God. The next thing that today, we're going to go to ingredient number two. Are you ready for number two? Okay, I'm going to give it to you right off the bat. The second ingredient is gift-oriented ministry. Gift-oriented ministry. You see, when you fall in love with Jesus, you know what ends up happening to you? Your heart changes, the Bible says. You get a new spirit in you. Those baptisms, it says that the old life is gone, the new life has come. And one of the things that happens to your heart is it does not, you no longer live for you, you live for Him. And John 3:16, one of the most famous verses in the Bible says, "For God so loved the world that He gave." God's a giving God. He's a generous God. He's a serving God. And so what happens is when you fall in love with Jesus with passion, guess what happens? You can't help it. You start serving. You start giving your life away. One of the cool things that I love about our pastors on our staff, from Pastor Mael, Pastor Rod, Pastor Rick, Pastor Isaiah, all of them, as they're walking through the campus, I've seen this all the time. Even Mael in her beautiful dress and high heels. When she sees Trask and she's walking by, she just walks right by. No, just kidding. She bends over and she picks it up. I've seen her time and time again throw things away, pick up garbage. Why? Because if you're too big to serve, you're too small to lead. Jesus said that one of the ways that you'll know one of my disciples, you'll love me, you'll love each other, and you'll serve. And how did He model that? He did the most disgusting thing I think you could do on the planet. He washed the disciples' feet. Anybody want your foot washed? Oh, okay. All right. We'll see you afterwards. All right. We'll wash your feet. See Dave in the back. We'll do it later. All right. That was really good, by the way. That didn't happen in the first service. Second service, we're alive today. I like it. We serve, don't we? We serve. But here's one of the problems that I've seen. Is that we serve, but we don't think, has God given me a gift to serve the body of Christ? In other words, has He given me talents? Has He given me desires and passions that can actually be used for God? And churches that flourish don't just say, hey, start sweeping the floor, start greeting, start doing all these things. Because what happens is if we just have this limited scope of what serving looks like, when you come in, all you think is, oh man, to serve God, you got to be a greeter, make coffee, shake a hand, hug. And for all the introverts in the room, they're like, oh, no more people. I just said hi to 50 people. I can't stand it anymore. And that is such a limited scope. There's an and to this. There's more to serving. In fact, on our at our church, we have something called a finance committee. We have people that come and meet once a month, and they look over our finances, people that, hello, have made money, praise God, that know how to manage their finances, and they look over our budget and they make sure we're staying within line. We have limits to the way that we spend our money, and they help us process that. And why do they do that? Because they have the gift to manage money. Deacons in our church, you know what the word deacon in the Bible actually means? Servant. So in order to move up and to serve as a deacon in our church, you actually have to serve the church first. You see, I want to do I'm hoping to just open your eyes to see that there is more to serving the body of Christ than maybe what you think there is. And what we need as a church, and you're going to see this in a moment, is for you to discover that you have a gift and the body of Christ needs you to serve. And this is the big idea this morning. If you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. The big idea this morning is this: you are divinely designed for ministry. You are divinely designed for ministry. And if some of you look at that, you're like, who, me? Yeah, you. Every single person was divinely designed for ministry. Look at your neighbor and say, he's talking to you. So we're like, really? Yes. How do I know that? Ephesians 2:20. It says this: for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the things he planned for us long ago. In the New King James Version, it says, for we are God's handiwork. How many know God doesn't make junk? When he created the world, he said, it was good. When he made you, it was good. And he has a plan for you. But the enemy comes to rob, steal, and kill your life so that you will not be fruitful in the kingdom of God, so that you won't thrive. And so what happens is you are divinely designed by God with gifts to be used in the kingdom of God. And then what ends up happening is you realize something kind of crazy. The dirt, the soil that you're in, you know what it is? It's dirty. And I just got to warn you real quick. People create messes. Did you know that? If you didn't, just have kids. People create messes. I remember going into somebody's house when we lived in Yakima, and the lady, she was really determined on having a very clean house. And we were walking in one day, and she had, have you been to the hospital? They have those little blue booties that go over your shoes. She had them to walk into her house. Even if you took your shoes off, she was trying to put them on you. I'll never forget this. I was like, wow, this is cool. All right, I got blue booties. Walk into your church, and she was just like, germ, no, 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 no. And I'm just telling you, one of the things that can happen is that you get dirty when you serve the kingdom of God. But I want to encourage you, you'll be okay. And in fact, you'll actually be stronger for it. You'll be used mightily in the kingdom of God. So what are we to do? We're to discover our gifts. But before we get there, I want you to understand something that Paul unpacks this so beautifully in Ephesians chapter 4, is that oftentimes we think that when you hire a pastor or you hire a teacher or you hire people in the church, that they are supposed to do all the work and the people are just supposed to pay for it, enjoy it, and then go home. And I want you to know that is an Americanized view of the church that's completely upside down and backwards. So I want to read this for you and see how that we work together. We actually function better together when we understand God's design for the church. So I want you to see what God's actual design is. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, Paul's writing this, and he says, as a prisoner for the Lord then. So Paul's in prison. What's he in prison for? Stealing, robbery, preaching the gospel, telling people about the Lord. He's preaching the gospel. He's in jail, and he says, I urge you to break me out of prison. Nope. He's less concerned about his life and more concerned about the word of God getting out. He says this, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Did you hear all that? Do you want me to open up the altar call right now? completely humble, gentle, patient, bearing with one another in love. The Lord has some work to do in my life. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. That word peace is the Greek word eirene, which means otherworldly peace. In other words, peace that does not come from your strength, but from the power of God. The bond of peace that unites us. There is, now listen to this, see if you can count how many times it says the word one. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Why is he saying one over and over and over? Because unity is one of God's primary concerns for his church. Because if we're divided, we can't stand. He wants us to be in unity. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and he gave gifts to his people. Did you see that? He gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself, so who is giving this? Ready? It's going to be gifts. Christ, this is Jesus. He gives the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers. So who gave these gifts? Let's all say it out loud. One, two, three. Christ. Okay, so Christ gave them. And why did he give these gifts? Verse 12, to equip his people for works of service. What's the purpose of the church? To equip people to do the works of the ministry. I was expecting more excitement. Okay, we'll get back. All right. To equip his people for works of service so that, there's a purpose, the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature. In other words, you will not be fully thriving and growing in Christ unless you're serving. Unless you found your ministry and you're doing something with it. You will always be immature, wondering why I'm not thriving. It actually is really important, not just for you, but for us as a body of Christ, that you discover your gifts. Why? Because you thriving matures the rest of us. It helps us become healthy. So here's what it says. The knowledge of the Son of God had become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And here's the warning. If you don't discover your gift and thrive, you know what's going to happen? Look at verse 14. If you do this, then you will no longer be infants. So if you don't do this, you'll be an infant, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people and the deceitful scheming. Man, we see that in our culture. People who are immature, you know what they do? They find all of their life's source and resources by the internet and YouTube gurus. The earth's flat. No, it's not. It's round. People are just fascinated. They're looking at Instagram. Literally, I saw this TikTok one time, and this is what I'm going to do with the rest of my life. What? We don't suffer for lack of information. We suffer for lack of transformation and wisdom. People are so hungry for more and more knowledge, they don't know how to apply anything to their life anymore. And so what ends up happening? Well, this guy said this guy said that, so I'm over here, and you know what ends up happening? I'm unstable in all I do. It's amazing. I have a friend who's a doctor when we were living in the Tri-Cities, and I was talking to him, and I asked him about a couple of things, and he said, and I was like a symptom, you know, and I was like, hey, I wonder if it's this, this, or this. And he goes, you've got to get off the internet, son. WebMD is not your friend right now. And we have more professionals, but we need more help than ever. How do we grow and mature? We discover that God has a divine design. Now listen to this, uniquely crafted for you. Not to be somebody else, but to be exactly who God made you to be, to discover what it is. Then you will grow up and mature because you are serving in the kingdom of God, in your gift. Yes, we do things that maybe not, you don't have to like find a spiritual gift test to do, like picking up trash or going out of the parking lot and saying hi to people. We should all be doing that. That's just like the normal things. But here's what I will say. If you discover your gift and you start using it for God's kingdom, I'm telling you, something changes in your life. You thrive like you've never thought before. I got to get back to the verse of Genesis. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. Who's the head? Is Pastor Nate the head? No. Christ is the head of this church. This is his church. In fact, in our bylaws, it says that the lead pastor finds his headship under Christ. Our leadership as a deacon board and pastors, all of us are continually seeking the wisdom and knowledge that comes from God, not from myself. We follow God's plan for ministry, not my plan. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. You were designed by God to do the work that he planned for you long ago. So here's my question for you. We're going to skip down the notes for a second. Everything I just told you was pointing to the fact that the soil of your life, the way that you will thrive, is dependent upon you being in a gift-oriented ministry. So you're divinely designed. This is a big idea. You are divinely designed for ministry. So the number one question I want you to write down, it's in your notes, I want you to put this in your fill-ins, is number one, your first job is to discover your gift. Do you know your spiritual gift? Do you know that God gave you spiritual gifts? Verse 7 told us this, but to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. Now, maybe you're listening to this and you're thinking, okay, I understand there's physical gifts, like I'm good with people, I'm good at hugging, I'm good at ministry, different types of things, but did you know that God actually gives supernatural spiritual gifts to his people? Some of you are like, really? So glad you want to find that out. Check this out. In 1 Corinthians 12, verse 4 through 11, there's actually a whole list of spiritual gifts. That's just my theme song for the verse. Here we go. You ready for this? There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are some kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds for working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. Now, check this out. Here's some lists. Now, to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. So why are the gifts given? For the common good, to bless other people, okay? We got that? Is it to glorify that person? No, it's to bless other people and to encourage them, right? To one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. So a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And to still another, the interpretation of tongues. All of these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. So God has distributed these spiritual gifts to you and to me. The question I have is, have you stopped to ask yourself, what's mine? God, like, I see this in Scripture. Is that really for me? And I want to first just blow this off the lid here. Yes. God wants you to mature and discover your spiritual gift. Why? Because we need you. As a church, we need you. We need you to flourish in your gifts. Why? Because we're better together when we're all serving the body of Christ within our spiritual gift. Yeah. It's just absolutely amazing. And what I have found in my own life is oftentimes when I discover these gifts, I start praying, asking the Holy Spirit, these gifts, not just one, but multiple, start coming up in my life. Things like prophecy, knowledge, speaking in tongues, interpretation. In case you're wondering, all of those things we see in Scripture, we still believe that they're available and working today. We believe that. Now, some people are like, listen to this, like, but I've seen some people that do that and they're weird. They freak me out. And I want to encourage you with something that's helped me a lot. They were weird before that happened. People are weird. Remember I said there's dirt? Hello? I don't want to throw away God because there's a crazy guy in the barn over there. I want all that God has for me. That's why we have each other to mature us. The Bible is very clear about order. It talks about that God is a God of order, not of disorder. That there is room that we can prophesy. The Spirit is subject to the prophet. We take turns. But here's the problem. Because of some bad theology and bad practices, people neglect the moving and the work of God in their lives. And you know who really hurts? All of us. Because we need each other to develop and grow so that we can mature one another. That's really what this design of God says, is that you need him, you need her, and we need each other to grow up and to discover our gifts. But I've seen not just bad practices or like people, you know, bad theology or different things like that, but I've seen another thing that stops the work, people discovering their gifts, is pain. There was a lady named Kim. I just read about her this week. When she was 5 years old, her mom passed away of cancer. And she was raised by her dad and her sister. And she says in her writing that her dad did the best that he could, loved them and brought them up, and they loved God. But, you know, all through her life growing up, she was longing for the affection of a mother. It was like a void in her heart. And so when she would go through school, she would whenever she had a female teacher, she would try and get close to this teacher. And she'd try and talk to her, and she just wanted to have praise, or this teacher to say, "I'm proud of you, I believe in you." She wanted it from a female so bad. And so this one teacher, she thought she was really connecting with, the little girl, Kim, started writing notes to her. And then day after day, each class she'd write a longer note. Then before long, she's writing a page, 2 pages, 3 pages. And the teacher kept getting these notes every single day. And so finally, after about a month of this, the teacher pulls the little girl aside and said, "Hey, sweetie, please don't write me any more notes. You're kind of overwhelming me, and you're not a very good writer anyways." Just absolutely crushed this little girl, and she refused to write any longer. Fast forward to her, she's 40 years old. She has 2 kids, and one of them's getting married. And her son comes up to her and says, "Mom, I need help with the wedding. We need some more finances. We can't pay for everything." And she's looking at her bank account. She doesn't know how she's going to pay for it. She runs into a man at church who says, "Hey, I'm starting this website with a blog. I think, would you mind helping me write this blog for some extra money?" Just out of nowhere. And she was like, "No, I don't write." And he goes, "Well, would you at least just give it a shot and see what you could do?" Something inside of her said, "Maybe I should give it a try." So she started writing on this blog. The website started taking off. Next thing you know, a Christian bookstore finds her writing and says, "Hey, would you help these authors be a ghostwriter and finish some books?" She's finished over 25 books that have sold all over. Why? Because she had a gift that the pain of life had robbed her. But at 40 years old, somebody, God showed up and said, "No, that gift's not done. You're not over. I have hope for you. I have a plan for you. And God will use your gift to glorify him." And I look at some of these people, some of you in this room, and I know that you've gone through pain. I know that you've had times in your life where you would rather just mail in and say, "You know what, this dirt is too heavy." But I'm here to tell you that God wants to use the greatest pain in your life. He can turn it for good. The biggest tragedy, I've seen it over and over and over, is when somebody has an amazing gift and they don't use it for the glory of God. Or how about this, they don't even use it. I see it all the time. From sports, I watch basketball players who had a bad coach, and next thing you know, they don't even go out and play anymore. They're tall, they're strong, they could be as great as they want to be, but because they got hurt, offended, they don't get back in the game. I've seen people in church life, and just like you sitting out here, and after a service, they'll sneak up, get on a piano and they'll play the most beautiful sounds. And I'm like, oh, you should play. And you know what they say? Not for me. But I can see the gift all over you. Pain will rob you from your destiny. But I'm here to tell you, we serve a God that can heal your pain, that can redeem your story, that can fulfill everything in your life. Because please hear me, this is so important. You must discover your gift, not just for you, but for generations to come. Your gift matures and builds up the body of Christ. So once you've discovered your gift, the second thing you need to do is be equipped to use your gifts in ministry. You've got to be equipped. What is equipping mean? Verse 12, to equip his people for works of service. What does equip look like? You know what it looks like? This is going to sound weird. God's given you this gift, just like this seed. And some of you, you've got lots of super seed. And the most scary thing that you will ever be asked to do is put yourself in the game with other people. And you get buried deep. And nobody sees what's going on behind the scenes. Nobody sees the work that you're putting in, the practice that you're in, the prayers that you're in, the things that you're doing for God over and over and over, and you're getting better at your craft. Nobody sees it. And what can happen is you could say, since nobody sees it, I don't even know if God sees it, I'm going to take myself out, and I can serve God all by myself. And I want to just challenge that thought. If you are somebody you know, maybe you're online, and you're not in a part of a body of Christ, you are not going to see your gift become to its full potential because you won't be equipped by others. Not just by pastors, but by other people in the room. We equip each other. And it's in the times when nobody else sees that God's preparing you for something great. There's a man named Mark Shim, and he grew up in a family with lots of pressure that he had to do three things. He had to pick one of three things. Number one, it was either going to be a doctor. Number two, a lawyer. Or number three, nothing. I listened to his testimony. He said, those are the three things my parents expected out of me. And if nothing was nothing, then they would disown me. So with that much pressure, he decided to be a doctor. And you know what he said? I hated being a doctor. I hated studying. He went 15 years in medical residency and doing his, like, I don't know, all the different places he had to go, but it took him 15 years to where he's about to become a doctor and get his own practice, and he's about to quit. He hates it. Making all kinds of money, happy with that, but hates his life. And somebody pulls him aside and says, have you heard of something called mercy ships? He's like, I've never heard of mercy ships. He said, well, come with me. So it's this huge cruise liner, flies over, gets off the plane, gets on this boat. And as he's walking on this boat, he sees child and parents and moms, and they've got tumors sticking out the side of their body. Their heads are sideways. And he's looking at them with tears in his eyes. And he says, I can heal them. I can do the surgery to heal them. And he said at that moment, he knew all of that time, all of that practice, all of the hours he spent by himself, nobody else saw. He hated what was happening in his life. And he said at that moment, I knew my purpose in life. God had made me just for this. I've been equipped for it. And since 2008, all he's done is mercy ships. He closed his practice and he lives his life doing everything he can, because he knows God has put him on this planet to heal people. Some of you here, you're a moment away from an intersection where God's going to say, you see that problem? I put you on this planet to answer it. You see, you will flourish like never before when you see a problem and God says, I put you here to solve it. You see, the problem that you and I have is sometimes the gifts that God's put in us, we don't see them. We don't like them. We don't want them. I wonder if Peter felt that way. You see, if you follow Peter's life in the Bible, when he was a disciple, you know what he kept doing? Screwing up over and over and over. He would speak before he was supposed to. He would act before he was supposed to. In fact, when Jesus is being arrested, He grabs his sword and cuts the dude's ear off. Jesus is like, Peter, come on, man. Goes over, finds the ear in the grass, wipes it off. Here, come here, buddy. The guy's bleeding. Healed him. And all of a sudden, the guy's like, my ear's back. And he looks at Peter and says, he who lives by the sword dies by the sword. I mean, and then Peter denies Jesus three times. I mean, Peter just screws up over and over and over and over. And then we see in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit falls. And guess who stands up to preach the very first sermon to explain to everybody what just happened? Peter. And 3,000 people get saved that day. Why? Because he was equipped by Jesus all that time, screwing up over and over and over, taking dirt, making a mess everywhere. And Jesus said, I'm not done with you. I'm not done with you. You're going to thrive. You may be here and you're like, man, I've made some mistakes. I've blown it. Yeah, so did Peter. And look what God did with him. Look what he can do with you. Look what he can do with me. Don't let the pain of your past rob you from the future and destiny that God has laid out for your life. Because we need you to flourish in the kingdom of God. The last thing, number three, is use your gifts to minister as a servant. As a servant. One of the worst things that you can do is when you start using your gifting and you start serving, you know what ends up happening to a lot of people? I see this time and time again. Pride gets in their way. And because they have a gift, they won't do anything different. Because they have elevated their status, and I just want to say this as lovingly as I can, we've got to be servant-oriented people. That's just who we are. That's our DNA. We're never too big to pick up trash or to do greeting or anything like that. But here's the thing. We have to come as servants. Otherwise, God says something really strong. He says, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. I don't know about you, but there's nobody I want opposing me like God. I mean, I could take opposition from people and other things, bad traffic, but if God's opposing me, that's a pretty big deal if you ask me. Use your gifts to minister as a servant. And why should you do that? Some of you are like, man, Pastor, that sounds good. Divinely designed by God. That's pretty cool. I like that. I got to discover my gifts. How do I discover my gifts? I am so glad you asked. We have a class here called Starting Point. And in this Starting Point, we actually give you a spiritual gift test that you take, and we will plug you into a ministry to help you develop. We have Wednesday nights Better Together where you can come and learn about end times, parenting, men's groups. And at this Wednesday, we're going to come early at 6, and I want to invite everybody. I'm expecting 200 of you, maybe 300. I don't know. We can get bigger by the time my evangelistic heart gets going. But I want all of you. Here's why. Listen, we're going to go into the sanctuary on Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. Carpet's ripped up. Everything's apart. And we're going to pray over the sanctuary. We're going to write down scriptures and promises. Why? Because it's better together. We need you to pray for our church. We're remodeling from what happened with the pipe burst. But we know that God is up to something big here at Portland Christian Center. And we need every person to bathe what's happening in prayer. Why? Because we need each other. We're stronger together. And if we don't do that, I want to read this last verse to you really quickly. This is what it says. Until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attained to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. What's that saying? When you use your gifts, that's how we mature. If you're not going to use your gift, we're not going to be as mature as we could be. This lump of dirt, maybe I'll pour water on it and let it become grass as the series goes the next 6 weeks. Why? You need to see this. There's divine potential in every single person in this room. And God wants to use you for his glory. Don't sit on the sidelines. Don't wait. Take your next step. So what's your next step? Just You can scan the QR code or text this number. Just text it, 503-905-6595. If you do that, you can fill a little connect card and we'll get you to Starting Point, discovering your gifts, and get you serving. Because every single person was designed by God to thrive, to serve in your gift, not just to do whatever needs to be done, which we do need to do, but in your gift. Would you stand with me as we get ready to wrap up this morning? I was talking to somebody and they were lamenting about, you know, I wish I was more outgoing. I wish that I could speak like you, Pastor Nate. I wish I could do these different things. And I looked at this person and I said, but we need you to be you. And what I didn't know is that this person had secretly been paying for kids to go to youth camps. Didn't want their names known, wasn't telling anybody. But just every once in a while, they would sneak up to Pastor Jason and say, is there anybody that can't go to camp? And whatever was left, they would write that check. Not for the glory of man, but for the glory of God. You see, we all have a gift. Are you using it for the glory of God? Whatever it is that God's put inside of you, and maybe you're having a hard time discovering it, what problems do you see? That's how you know. You can answer it. You see a problem, you meet it. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes just for a moment? There are people in this room, I've just been praying, Holy Spirit, to reveal the truth of the gospel to them, because the truth is, without Jesus, this life is lost. Without Jesus, I don't know how I'd make it. And there's some here in this room that you need to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, whether you're online or in this room. If that's you, would you just raise your hand right where you're at? I want to pray for you to receive Jesus. Thank you. I see that hand. That's awesome. I see that. That's awesome. Yeah, over there, I see that hand too. Thank you. Anybody else, raise your hand if you want to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus. Lots of hands. You can put your hands down. Would you repeat this prayer with me? Church, everybody together, say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Wash me and make me new. I'm going to follow you all the days of my life. I love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's praise the Lord for those that raise their hand. Thank you, Jesus. If you raised your hand and you prayed that prayer, we would love to follow up with you. You can text that number again, and we will follow up with you, or stop by the hub and where that sign says, your best yes. That's your best yes. This next part of the message, as we get ready to worship Jesus, I just believe the Holy Spirit is stirring something powerful in our church. There are people in this room right now. God wants to use you. And the image that as I was praying, the Holy Spirit kept showing me in basketball, we're in a gym, so I can use that illustration if I want, all right? But in basketball, there are certain players that just stand out. They're just huge or good or whatever, and they do great things. But there's one player, my favorite, his name's Steph Curry. I like the Curry flurry, where he shoots lots of threes and all those different things. But as I was watching him one time, there was a bad call, he got hurt, and he took his mouth guard and he chucked it. And the ref gave him a T and kicked him out. And as he was walking off the court, you know, he was kind of embarrassed and things. And I thought about this, what if that one instant he never got back on the court again? One mistake, one failure. In front of millions of people, he was embarrassed. And he never got back on the court. I think there are people in this room that have had that happen to them. And they're not getting back in the game. You've been hurt, you've been offended, you've been lied to. You've been disappointed. People have let you down. And you see, there comes a point in a service where you have to ask yourself, Holy Spirit, I'm hurt. I need Jesus to heal me. I need to get back in the game, but this hurts too much. I want to throw in the towel so bad. But I want to tell you, the Holy Spirit, He's our advocate. He's our helper. He's saying, don't give up. Don't quit. I want to help you. I want to heal your heart. I want you to get back in the game. We need you. We need you. If that's you and you just need a touch from the Holy Spirit to heal what's been broken in your life, would you just raise your hand? I want to pray with you. I want to thank you. I see those hands. Yeah, keep them up for a second. Lots of pain. Yeah, lots of pain. Let's just pray for you. Keep your hand up. I want to pray for you. So, Father, right now, yeah, I see those hands. Come on, lots of hands. So, Lord, right now, I pray for anybody here, Lord, with their hands raised, the courage it takes to raise your hand and say, yeah, I've been hurt. People have offended me. People have hurt me. And I want to get out of the game. And Jesus is saying, I'm not done with you yet. I see you. I see your pain. I see your loneliness. I see you want to quit. But Jesus is saying, I'm not done. I'm not done with you. I love you. I have put those gifts in you for a reason. Don't quit. Don't give up. Allow Him to use you. Use your gifts to further the kingdom of God, and you'll thrive like never before. Jesus, heal these hearts, I pray.